This is our regular Saturday afternoon sponsorship workshop. Glad to see you guys here. I'm happy you're here. We'll have some fun today and get started on the second step. And this step is really a pivot point. It's utterly essential, and yet it's relatively simple. Sometimes I think we make way too much heavy going of the second step. As with the first step, ultimately the second step comes to us as a gift. It's not the kind of thing that we can talk ourselves into or force ourselves to have. And we can talk about it, we can act as if, but the truth is that having come to a conclusion and having reached a belief, we either have that belief or we don't. And no amount of acting as if is going to make any difference. But there are things that we can do as sponsors, and we're going to talk about that and how we go about dealing with this second step. First of all, I guess the thing that we have to get by first is this question of being restored to sanity. If you listen carefully in the rooms, you're going to hear a lot of people question this business of, by implication, if I'm to be restored to sanity, it means that I have been insane, or I am now insane. And of course, the sad fact is that in almost every case, that's the truth. When we come through the door, our minds don't work right. With some of us, it's a certifiable insanity of the clinical type, but that's very rare. For almost everyone else, what we're really talking about is the fact that our minds have stopped working as God intended them to work. And let's look to see how that is. God gave us natural instincts for sex and security and society. And these are good. They're meant for our good and for the good of the race, for the good of humankind. Without the sex instinct, procreation would be spotty at best. Very doubtful if the human race would have survived. The instinct for society is what keeps us together and allows us to function as groups rather than as lone individuals that constantly at war with each other over territory. And as groups, we're able to come to some agreements as to how we conduct ourselves. And so the instinct for society is very powerful and very, very important. And it is necessary, and it's God-given. The instinct for security, likewise. This instinct is strong enough that we have a great will to live, and we are alert to danger, and we seek to be secure in our persons and to secure the safety of our loved ones. And so if we look at these three natural instincts, we can understand that we were born with these. They are instinctual, which means that they operate below the level of conscious thought. This is back brain stuff. You can test that for yourself. If you recognize that if you see someone of the opposite sex who is attractive to you and you become sexually aroused, you didn't have to tell yourself to do that. It just happens. When we feel that we are being ostracized or shunned, or we fear that we might be, the tremor that goes through us, to be being set aside in the society of our fellows and our peers, is a very real and serious fear. It's a tremendous anxiety. And we will do almost anything to be able to stay within the society. The Scarlet Letter, Hester Prynne, or Prynne, being ostracized and being made to wear the block letter A. She could stay in the colony, but nobody would talk to her. It's one of the worst forms of punishment ever devised. And shunning is still practiced today in some religious sects. And with primitive people, shunning almost always leads to death. The Aborigine who is shunned in Australia knows that they will soon die, and they simply hasten their own death. So again, we're talking about a very, very powerful force in our lives. So long as these instincts remain intact and as God gave them to us, our minds work perfectly well. But what happens is that we become swamped with overwhelming fear, and fear warps and perverts our natural instincts so that they no longer function as God intended. They don't work for us anymore, they work against us. We do crazy, irrational things. We operate in crazy, irrational ways. Our minds are filled with irrational thoughts, thoughts in collision with each other. And what happens is that we become totally localized in self, and selfishness, and self-centeredness, self-centered fear. And when, as we live in self, we alienate ourselves more and more from God, even if we had a God of our childhood. We can identify the culprit, the force which warps our natural instincts and drives us insane, as fear, anxiety, terror. Actually, the four horsemen that talks about in chapter 11. Terror, bewilderment, frustration, despair. And all of these powerful negative forces take our natural instincts and make them into something that God never intended. Well, when we understand that, then we will understand what it says in chapter 4, that lack of power is our dilemma, and that we have to find a power by which we can live. Because what it's really telling us is that we're not only powerless over, but we're powerless over our thinking. We're not powerless over our actions. Make no mistake about that. And when you're sponsoring somebody, it's never wise to let them off the hook for the things they did. They will want you to do that. They will want you to provide them the excuse that their actions were motivated by their illness. But in almost every case, they did things which they knew were wrong when they did them. Went against whatever moral or ethical or sense of rightness they might have had. Not only did they know that those things were wrong, but they knew that in the past doing those things had resulted in a disaster. And yet they continued to do them. But we are powerless over our thinking. And this means, quite simply, that we're going to have God's help to be brought back to sanity. Because it's axiomatic that one cannot cure a sick mind with a sick mind. We can bring all of the psychology and psychiatry to bear that we want on these natural instincts that have gone awry. And we can recognize and see that where we're off base. And we may even have some temporary relief. But the truth of the matter is that the insanity remains because the problem has not been solved. Now, of course, we also, when we look at this question of insanity, we also must look at the insanity of that next, which we have been doing over and over and over again, in spite of knowledge of the severe consequences which were likely to follow, or in some cases sure to follow. Not only that, but some of us have tried finding out all about ourselves, getting all this self-knowledge, so-called keeping it green and remembering your last drink and all that stuff, and that never worked, because there would always come a time when nothing would stand between us and but a loving God, and we didn't have him. And so we need to look at this question of insanity from both sides, or both angles. The insanity of the next, and the warping of our natural instincts, which means that our minds no longer function as God intended. And this is the problem that we come in with, and this is the problem which the second step addresses. One of the things which is very important for you to do when you first start talking about a second step with your sponsees, and once you have explained to them what the problem is, it's really important to show them that this problem will be solved. At the bottom of page 84, Debbie, read that out loud for us, will you?
As we have ceased fighting anything or anyone, even now, for by this time sanity will have returned.
What did you just say? For this time, what?
For by this time sanity will have returned.
Sanity will have returned. Go ahead, let's read on.
We will seldom be interested. If tempted, we recoil from it as if from a hot flame. We react sanely and normally, and we'll find out how this has happened automatically. We'll see that our own new attitude has been given us without any thought or effort on our part. Just comes.
Good, that's good. That's the point. Sanity is returned to us by the time we reach the 10th step, if not way before. And so this is not an idle step, this second step. As a matter of fact, coming to believe is quite rational, isn't it? If we look forward and we see that the experience of all the others who have worked the steps, as reported in the big book, is that God indeed does restore us to sanity, and this will happen by the time we've reached the 10th step. And so, in working with your sponsees, it's always good, if you can, to bring them hope along with showing them what the problem is. Because this, remember that they came in a hopeless state of mind and body. This is quite common. Almost everybody has hopelessness in their makeup to one extent or another, although they may not articulate it, you should expect that it's there. So we do everything we can to continuously feed them large measures of hope. It is hope that will sustain them at first. We think that it's fear, but it's not. Fear is the enemy. Fear is the antithesis of hope. So what we do is we bring them as much hope as possible. That is the force which will motivate them to keep trying. Now then, if we think then in terms of being insane, and now we're going to want to come to believe that there is a God out there, a God of our own understanding, who can restore us to sanity. Notice that the language of the second step is not declamatory. It does not say will. It says can. And the reason that it says can is that we have much, much work to do. There's nothing automatic about being restored to sanity simply because we come to believe that God can do it. We've got a long way left to go, and we have to play our part in this scenario all the way through. So So the coming to believe is the coming to believe that there is a power out there greater than ourselves, which is strong enough, powerful enough, omniscient enough to restore us to sanity. You see how simple the second step really is. However, it is not simple for many newcomers because they're in such a state of mind about God and such denial and such fear. In most cases, it's terror-stricken about the idea that what God's going to do to them when he gets hold of them. Or if they acknowledge God, they suddenly find themselves subject to his realm and they're going to be in deep, deep trouble. So either from an intellectual lack of belief, which is rare, or out of fear and consternation and guilt and shame and remorse, they're going to hang back and not want to acknowledge this idea that this higher power is out there and has a direct personal interest in them. Now here's one of the biggest problems you face, and it's seldom articulated, but you need to know that it exists. The person who is agnostic or even proclaims atheism, which is very, very rare, but you know, once in a while you run into it, that person generally is saying to you in another way, yep, there might be something out there that's making all this stuff go. Maybe even that created the planets and everything, and the stars, and all the space in between. But it's ludicrous to think that this great power could have any interest whatsoever in a single solitary human being such as me. It's ridiculous to even think about this massive force having any personal interest in little me. And I refuse to accept the idea that could be so. In other words, a God personal to me, a God who is interested in each human being. Now the big book says that we find that God is interested in us humans if we want him enough. Now this is the dilemma that Bill Wilson faced, remember? Because as he reports in his story and as your sponsee reads the book, one of the things you're going to read is what happened with Bill in this. In Bill's case, it was exactly that. He could visualize some power of the spheres that makes everything operate, maybe a celestial timekeeper or motion keeper or whatever. But he fell far short of believing that this great power could have anything to do with him personally. And it was only after Ebby had come to him and said, now look, Bill, this is not a religion here that we're talking about. There is no standardized God that you have to appeal to. And nobody's going to catechize you on this to see whether or not you believe as we believe. As a matter of fact, he said, you are free to choose your own conception of God, whatever that may be, no matter how weak or inadequate it may be. If you do that, you'll have a head start on all this stuff. The other thing that Ebby told him was, it is not necessary in order for you to recover that you have a full-blown belief in a God personal to you who is looking out after your welfare, who's kind and loving and wants only the best for you, and is going to respond to you as you seek him. You don't have to believe that right now. What you must do is you must be willing to believe that this is so. And it is that willingness which opens the door. Now, this is the first time as your sponsee is going through the steps where this willingness really hits home. But willingness is going to come into play all the way through the steps. Just as an example, in doing the ninth step, there are many amends that we can't make for one reason or another. The key is, are we willing to make them if we can? Because if we're willing to make them, if we can, we will be relieved of the burden of guilt that we're carrying as a result of those, the wrongs that we've done. Over and over again, this whole question of willingness comes up, and it starts out right here with the second step. One of the things that's kind of cute, but it works, you take this atheist or agnostic and you say to them, if you're not willing to believe, all you need to do is ask the God you don't believe in to make you willing, and the willingness will come. It sounds like a conundrum or a paradox, but actually it's pretty practical, because what happens when they do that, praying to whom it may concern, or God if you're there, it doesn't really matter. They open up the door just a little crack and God comes flooding in. And Bill reports this to it. We find it both in the language of the heart and in back issues of the grapevine, and in As Bill Sees It, where he reports to us that he learned that he had to pray just as if there were a God. And then when the miracles started coming and he could no longer deny they came from a power greater than himself, that's when faith came. And of course we know what happened with him when he really went after this whole idea of seeking God, and he asked God to show himself if he was there. That's when Bill had his epiphany, his major spiritual experience. As we work with our newcomers, we need to understand what we're dealing with. And it's very important to recognize that most atheists and agnostics are dealing from a base of fear and shame and guilt and remorse. It's very unlikely that they have ever really achieved a total intellectual nihilism where they have decided that there cannot be a God. It's almost as if this becomes the smart thing to do. Nevertheless, it's their story and they'll sometimes stick to it. So we need to be able to show them a way to get past that. And one of the most important things is to demonstrate to your sponsee that you understand what they're going through. You understand that they're having a great deal of difficulty accepting the idea that this huge power out there can have any interest in them personally. And you understand that, but you tell them we're going to work past that. And the first way we do that is for you just to become willing to believe. Not that you have to believe yet, just that you become willing to believe. We'll take another look at that when we get into chapter 4. Now then, it's very important in order for your sponsee to have an understanding of how the second step is going to help them, that they have become familiar with the reading of the big book. And we're going to go back before the fourth chapter to the third chapter, and we're going to see where the third chapter details for us the insanity of the first. If you'll turn to page 35. If you don't have a book, there's some up. You got your book? Okay. Now there are two real stories in this last part of chapter 3. This first one is the story of Jim, and then there is the story of Fred, and sandwiched in between Jim and Fred is the allegory of the jaywalk. And all three of these stories, or the two stories and the allegory, are designed to get the newcomer to recognize just how screwy they are when it comes to this question of booze, or in the case of an addict, the drugs. That there is something completely messed up in their heads, and something over which they have no power. The story of Jim, on page 35, Jim inherited a good-sized automobile dealership. He lost his company, and eventually when he got sober enough, he went back to work for the old company as a salesman. And Jim had come to the boys, and they had done their best to enlighten him about what was wrong with him and what he was going to need to do in order to recover. He knew all about what was coming to him if he drank again. He knew that he would very easily could lose his family. He knew he would be going back to the insane asylum. Didn't have treatment centers then. He threw you in with all the crazies. And he knew all this could happen, would happen if he kept drinking or if he drank again. But he couldn't stop. And everything that the boys told him, he said yes, yes, yes to, but he still insisted in his own mind that he could beat the game alone. Then one day, and he'd been told that there would always be these times when he would succumb to it without any further thought. You know, a lot of people keep talking about this, been a think it through. Well, that's fine if your mind is still working in that direction, but a lot of times that doesn't work at all. Some people are of the opinion, for example, that we always set ourselves up, that we've been thinking about days or weeks before we do, and sure, that's true sometimes, but absolutely is not always true. And it's a serious mistake to think that we have this period of grace when we can somehow or another put the brakes on the next spree. And sometimes we can and sometimes we can't. But you see, that is a long, long, long way from being a solution to anything. Because the solution is to be set free from the obsession and the compulsion to drink for good and all. And we do that by working the steps and getting a close personal contact with a loving God, staying close and performing His work well, and progressing spiritually on a daily basis. That's the way that we insulate ourselves from this insanity, because that's exactly what it is. So now Jim went to his dealership that day, and he had to go out into the country to see a customer. Got in a little bit of a fight with the new boss, who the new owner had taken over his business. And then he motored on out into the country to see a customer. He stopped at a roadhouse where he often stopped for lunch. He sat down and ordered a sandwich, and he ate that and had some milk. And after he finished, he thought, well, back in the asylum, and his wife was getting ready to leave him, and he lost his job. What happened? How could this have happened? On page 36, read this. Middle paragraph. Suddenly the thought crossed my mind that if I were to put an ounce of whiskey in my milk, it couldn't hurt me on a full stomach. I ordered a whiskey and poured it into the milk. I vaguely sensed I was not being any too smart, but felt reassured as I was taking the whiskey on a full stomach. Going down, thus started one more journey to the asylum for Jim. Here was the threat of commitment, the loss of family and position, to say nothing of that intense mental and physical suffering which drinking always caused him. Listen to this now. He had much knowledge about himself as an alcoholic, yet all reasons for not drinking were easily pushed aside in favor of the foolish idea that he could take whiskey if only he mixed it with milk. There's a lesson here on self-knowledge. By the best efforts of those in the rehabilitation community, the professionals, to show us and have us learn what's wrong with us and what our story is and what are all of our weaknesses and all that stuff. And to go into encounter groups and having people calling us on our, what they call, calling us on our shit and all that stuff. And we learn all about ourselves, and this includes being psychoanalyzed, spending months, weeks, or years with a psychiatrist, as Roland H. did with Dr. Young. By the way, Dr. Young's picture is right up there on the end wall. Dr. Young was a great friend of, because he recognized that we were doing things which he could not do. And he was a very spiritual guy. Roland H. had been torn apart, his psyche completely torn apart and rebuilt by Dr. Young in the year that Roland spent with him in Switzerland. When he came back to the United States, he had all his self-knowledge, and within a couple of months he was... And finally, Dr. Young had to admit to him, Roland, you are of that incorrigible, chronic alcoholic type that we can do nothing for. Self-knowledge, he said, all the knowledge about yourself won't keep you sober. If you don't have some power in your life which is powerful enough to defeat the alcoholism, you're going to die from it. And I can do nothing more for you, he said. I cannot help you any further. Whatever the precise definition of the word may be, we call this plain insanity. How can such a lack of proportion of the ability to think straight be called anything else? So you see that we have a direct object lesson here for our sponsees dealing with this question of insanity. Why is the second step necessary? Why do we need to be restored to sanity? Why can't we, for God's sake, just stop? There's much repair work that has to be done, and it all eventually is going to be done by God. But we always have to do our part. The guy that runs the place, he doesn't like me at all.
Yeah.
And, he and his people have started a rumor that I charge $75 to do a fist step.
Oh, it's only $50.
Everybody knows that. No, this is a three-quarter way house or a halfway house.
Where's it at?
Down by.
You don't charge nothing.
Of course not.
I didn't know
the fist step's free. Absolution. Absolution costs you $50.
Like, oh, well, it's steps or anything.
I sell indulgences.
Yeah, I was just gonna say.
That's a hell of a lot more than $75.
Can I buy indiscretion, please?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Fist steps free is absolution.
It costs
money.
That's right.
I learned that from a church that's been around forever.
But that's brand new. I've never heard that one before.
Wow.
They're getting more outrageous. They were circulating the rumor for a while that I was run out of Dade County.
That's true. I heard that one myself. Wait, I might have started that one. Let's see.
Well, yeah, if anybody would know, you'd know. You've been down there with me. They hate me down there. Every time we go to the room, you can see it, can't you?
Well, yeah.
You got something they just can't seem to grasp. They'll make some shit up about.
I don't know. It's weird. I guess it's kind of flattering that they're paying that much attention.
But that's what alcoholics do. They want to knock somebody down so they feel better.
Of course.
They find loopholes that you're, or something. Oh, God, he's human. Let's talk about him.
Now they're talking about, they won't come to my meetings because it's a Jim B. lecture. I don't go to them Jim B. lectures.
Hey, Jim.
What?
Keep doing what you're doing.
What?
Keep doing what you're doing.
Oh, I don't, You have no idea how many times I've been through this same thing.
Well,
this place up here waited a little bit longer than usual to get on my case. I had a pretty nice honeymoon here for about 10 months. But it's all coming loose now.
I think old Luke's
getting off your case.
Yeah, he is.
He's kind of letting up.
Well, natural that he would. He started working the steps.
Oh,
he found out what we're talking about here is right.
You mean out of the book he's working the steps?
Apparently.
He's not working his own steps anymore?
Apparently so.
I can't believe that.
Now, Jim.
What?
I hope to graduate one day to the position of having rumors started about me.
Yeah, I know. It's pretty flattering, actually. You know, Miami's playing Virginia Tech today. I bet you we don't have, this may be it. It doesn't matter a bit. You've been in some pretty small meetings, workshops with me, haven't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We all shared.
3, 4, 5 people. Yeah, that's okay. I don't care. I just keep going.
For a while, we did too. It was Jimmy, I think his name was, and me.
That's right. Yeah, when we first started down in Miami.
Yeah. Yeah.
How many you need for a meeting?
The three of us, the four of us, are plenty.
We could almost have a minion night.
We'll have 150 tonight.
Which one are you doing tonight?
I'm not sure. I don't remember. I count on you to tell me.
Oh, I listen to you all the time, Jim. I mean, I don't know. You could be on step 7 for all I know.
I can't remember. Wait a minute. No, I'm going to start step 2 tonight. Then.
Yeah, because you're going to have step 2 late. You said something. If I really wanted a recording in case I wasn't here. So
yeah.
Well, you said, yeah.
Yep, we'll start step 2 down there tonight, too.
Great, that's
wonderful. It's funny how all three of these meetings dovetail. Well, I started step 1 and all three of them at the same time. It just happened that way.
There's going to be a guy doing the step series that's over on South Beach, and it really happened by default, and I don't know whether it was God doing it or the devil doing it, but I'm not going to go. I don't like. Last week there was a guy doing the step series, and I haven't been going, but I had a chair at the meeting, and I said to myself, okay, Billy, just be open-minded, listen to this guy, maybe there's one or two things that he's going to say that you're going to catch on to. And within 3 minutes, I could not listen to him anymore. So you know what I did? I went into a meditative trance.
Good, yeah.
And I meditated it was the longest meditation I ever had in my life. And I came out of it every 10 minutes, and I just looked at the time to make sure that, because I was chairing the meeting.
Yeah.
It was the longest meditative thing I ever had. It lasted a good 40 minutes.
Well, that's good. And he did you a big favor.
Because I couldn't listen to this guy. There's another guy, and you know the guy who's going to do the step series. His name's...
Oh, God.
He doesn't know a damn... Excuse me. He doesn't know a darn thing, unfortunately.
Nope. Sure doesn't.
So that frees up.
Claudio's a nice guy.
He's an awfully nice guy. He's a
pro, or used to be.
He's a blabbermouth.
Yep.
Just don't want to listen to him.
Well, there are very few people who can handle all 12 steps and do it right. There are few in Miami because Miami's been doing it for years. And they've got a kind of a star system down there.
I try to get Brad. I tried to get the guy who's doing the meeting to get Brad.
Yeah.
We haven't heard him for a while. He's busy, so.
Well, Brad and the Big O and Father Jim doesn't do a bad job. And
now my Monday nights are free. There's no way I'm going to listen to him. I'm not going to torture myself.
Isn't too bad.
Yeah, I really like her. She has a different message, but a really good, solid one.
Yeah, she's a good speaker, and she's at least enthusiastic about it, and she practices what she preaches. I ran into a lot of her friends when I was down in the Keys a few weeks ago. I think she's hanging out mainly at Homestead now. Homestead's a good room. If you haven't been to a meeting there, they there's a lot of old-time AA in that room. A bunch of bikers, South Alabamans. You know, I never saw such pure AA anywhere as I did in South Alabama. That's...
Yeah, I knew a kid from South Alabama.
Right down the line, man.
Pretty good.
Ivan knows, that's where he's from.
It was good enough to keep me sober 15 years.
Yep.
I met a kid in Minneapolis from Alabama, and he walked around with his big book no matter where he went. That's somebody I want to know.
I wanted to ask you something, gentlemen, before you get started. Are you familiar with the Anonymous Press?
The what?
The Anonymous Press.
Anonymous Press?
They put out a Big Book Index. They put out a Big Book Study Edition.
Oh, yeah, I know who they are. They're out of Washington State.
They are available to USA.